Hachette Audio presents For the Benefit of Those Who See, Dispatches from the World of the Blind, written and read by Rosemary Mahoney.
For Stephen Anthony Mahoney. Chapter 1. Vision. Not long ago, I accompanied my boyfriend to Jerusalem for his laser eye surgery appointment. From Cyprus, where Eos lives, Israel is a 40-minute flight. You've hardly taken off from Larnaca's tiny airport before you're skidding to a landing again at Ben Gurion Airport in Tel Aviv. The surgery took place in the private clinic of an Israeli ophthalmologist of considerable reputation. This ophthalmologist doesn't smile much, but his mouth is slightly lopsided in a way that makes him look perpetually on the verge of a smile. He looks as though he's privately enjoying a mildly amusing joke, although after spending 20 minutes in his company, one suspects there really is no joke. It's just the way his mouth is. He is short and stocky and neckless, and though his eyes are small and set close together, and though he doesn't truly smile, there is warmth in his face. He walks slumped a bit to the right, as if he has too much ballast in his starboard pocket, and he moves through his clinic in a dogged way, like a weary commuter trudging through Grand Central Station at rush hour. His pending smile notwithstanding, I got the distinct sense that the surgeon was thoroughly bored with his job. At any one time, there were approximately 15 patients sitting in his waiting room, waiting for a first consultation, or waiting for their surgeries, or waiting, eyes bandaged, for their follow-up appointments. Each time I found myself in this room, and I found myself there on three separate occasions, I could not refrain from counting the number of patients and doing a little mathematical calculation. If Eos was paying 4,000 euros for his surgery, then the others probably were too. 15 times 4,000 equals quite a lot. The ophthalmologist was possibly bored, but certainly rich. In first consultation, the surgeon explains the process with sentences he has used hundreds, perhaps thousands of times before. His style is sleepily deadpan, which somehow lends him an air of incontrovertible authority. Probably because he's required to, he offers a brief overview of the possible negative outcomes of the procedure. That one in a million chance that you will emerge from his surgery worse off than when you went in. That wholly far-fetched possibility that you might come out of his surgery not just your same old presbyopic self, but plumb blind. Or, if not blind, then at least optically diminished in one way or another. After detailing these disturbing possibilities, the surgeon looks at you and blinks dryly, waiting for your horrified reaction. The dry blinking is a prompting of sorts, a cue, a wry indication that you have nothing to worry about, that it is extremely unlikely that you will go blind under his expert care. And so, somewhat intimidated by the entire enterprise, swept along by the rush of medical language, and quite in the dark as to what it all means, a bit too polite to turn back now, the patient does not react in horror, but simply nods and smiles with false detachment to show that, yes, of course, it would be ridiculous and perhaps a bit hysterical of him to think that he might come out of this costly surgery worse off than when he went in. Before beginning his work on AS that day, the surgeon asked me if I'd like to observe the procedure from a small room adjoining the operating theater. From there, I'd be able to see the surgery, not only through a plate glass window, but also highly magnified on a television screen above the window. An exact broadcast of what the surgeon himself saw through his double-barreled microscope. Generally eager to observe just about anything new, greedy for any unusual experience, easily seduced by the wonders of modern technology, and lulled by the surgeon's dispassionate manner, I said without thinking, "Yes." Of course, the moment I saw Eos's eye, that most vulnerable of organs, tremblingly huge on the screen, I felt that perhaps I had made a mistake in choosing to observe. Magnified 1,000 times, the eyelids looked like desert dunes, the lashes like wind-tossed palms, the creases in the skin like 100 parched arroyos. The rims of the enormous lids were raw and pink, damp and very tender-looking. The blue iris so immense it looked astral, like an exploding star, and the crimson blood vessels were dense and tangled as tree roots. How horribly exposed that eye appeared, How creepily suprahuman. In a sympathetic reaction of discomfort, my own eyes began to blink and water. Presently, a sort of screen slid across the eyeball, like a paper-thin sheet of ice, and then it crumpled, and the eye was bathed in a foam of crystalline bubbles that slowly dissolved. Next, a metal clamp appeared, dug deep beneath the edges of the upper and lower lids, and pried them wide apart. And then a spade-shaped scalpel blade moved into view, hovering half an inch above the glittering eyeball. At the sight of this razor so close to the eye, I felt my face clench into a grimace, and my right hand leaped involuntarily to my throat in a nonsensical gesture of self-defense. I had made a mistake in choosing to watch, but having agreed to do it, I could not now look away. It was a matter of both stubborn pride and obsessive curiosity. The tip of the scalpel pierced the cornea at the edge of the iris and began to carve its way around the brilliant blue circumference. I am not a squeamish person, but at the sight of this piercing, it was all I could do to keep myself from shrieking and running out of the room. The cornea, the transparent film that protects the iris and the pupil, is, by the way, one of the most sensitive tissues of the human body, packed with so many hotly vibrating nerves that the slightest intrusion produces an explosion of excruciating pain. If you haven't gleaned this fact from your own life's experience, you are an unusual person indeed. With a small hook, the surgeon lifted the clear circular flap of cornea that he had, but for a small connective strand of tissue, cut free from the eyeball, and flipped it up like the nearly severed lid of a tin can. The black pupil at the center of all this activity continued to stare straight ahead, spookily, not moving a fraction of an inch left or right, as if mesmerized by visions of an apocalyptic future. I looked away from the screen and through the window into the operating room. The surgeon's back was to me. Dressed in a sky blue robe and puffy blue shower cap, he was hunched over his microscope, his two small eyes pressed to its eyepieces, while a big-hipped nurse stood slightly behind him in the posture of a lobster. Elbows crooked and lifted slightly away from her body, gloved hands raised near her ears, and a swab of cotton pincered between the thumb and forefinger of each hand. Several inches beneath the bottom lens of the microscope, Eas's face was bathed in a pool of intense orange light. The surgeon's gloved hands basked and darted in the pool like fish in a tank. More disturbing things happened in this surgery. Drops of liquid were flung rudely into the eye. Cotton swabs were raked across the eyeball. An intensely bright and vibrating laser strobe light circled around and around the dilated pupil, and all of this in a manner that seemed blunt and savage. It was like watching a seal pup being torn to shreds by a ravening shark. At some point, I realized that in my distress, my left hand had joined my right hand at my throat to assist in the self-defense, as if perhaps I was expecting the scalpel to jump out of the screen and take a stab at me. I watched the surgery but tried not to perceive it, saw the violated eye but tried not to comprehend it. Yet it was impossible to remain calm while viewing this lurid physical anathema. The surgical hook appeared again and fitted the slick layer of cornea back over the iris with a jaunty little flip of dismissal. Ho-hum, that one's done. Next, please. I stared, fixated. What would keep the almost severed cornea in place now? What would prevent it from falling out and dangling on Eas's eyelash when he stood up? From the corner of my eye, I saw a rapid blur of motion near the window. It was the surgeon. He had turned toward me and was waving his scalpel in friendly greeting. Having caught my attention, he gave me a wink above his surgical mask and added to it a jocular little hula-esque swing of his hips and the double thumbs-up sign to show that all had gone well with the first eye. The surgeon, though he didn't smile, was kind of a humorous guy, an actor of sorts, and maybe, I thought, a touch peculiar, precisely because he did not smile as he made these vaudevillian gestures. Though his mouth was hidden by the mask, it was obvious from the steady, lightless look in his eyes that he wasn't smiling. His nurse, however, was smiling liberally behind her mask, her eyes narrowing a fraction and transmitting a sudden, excited illumination the moment her boss began doing his little dance. The surgeon must have seen that my face, as I'd been looking up at the screen, was twisted into a grimace. He must have thought I was nervous and afraid, and must have been trying to reassure me. If that was what he was thinking, he was quite right. I was nervous and afraid, because I, for one, have a morbid fear of losing my eyesight. When I was a senior in college, I was playing squash with my friend Vicky one cold February evening, when she wound up powerfully for a swing and, in the process, struck me square in the right eye with her racket. The blow was so sudden and unexpected that I had no time at all to close the eye, and the edge of the racket...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.